Hey everyone, this past weekend, me and Matt got to head out to RTX 2019 and chat with a few people. Here is our interview with CEO of Octopie and executive producer of Netflix's Magic the Gathering, Isaac Krauss. Enjoy and excuse the noise. So say your full name, position, how you want to be referenced.
Cool. I am Isaac Krauss. I am the CEO of Octopie and the executive producer of Magic the Gathering.
That must be amazing to say.
It's interesting. It's kind of something that I have to kind of like work myself into. I've been executive producer on series before. I've kind of been the default showrunner in some cases on some shows because of Octopie being a really new company. We have to all wear a lot of hats. This show, with the gravity of the show and the scale of the team, everything like that, it's a lot, but it really kind of feels natural, and it's really exciting because it feels good, and I'm surrounded by so many talented expert people that I'm learning something new every day, and I can feel like the growth of my career and what I get to do now with animation.
So why don't you tell us a little bit about Octopie? So anybody who's listening who hasn't heard of you
sure.
guys.
So Octopie is an animation company, and I say that as the most general term possible because there's a lot of detail there that a lot of people normally their eyes glaze over and they don't know what the hell I'm talking about. Octopie is two things. It's basically two divisions. One side of our company is a network. And what I mean by network is that we create original IP, intellectual property, and we distribute it ourselves. And we distribute it on our own platforms, meaning YouTube, Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, basically free platforms with very low or no barrier to entry for us to find a fan for our IP. And then the other side of Octopie is kind of like a traditional animation studio. We are hired by other networks and other owners of IP to create animation for them. So Magic the Gathering would be an example of what we do from our Octopie Productions perspective, which is we don't own Magic the Gathering, and we're not Netflix, and we're not distributing it. So it means that we just are coming in as experts of producing animation, and we are making sure that the show is everything that it needs to be to excite and fulfill the current fans of Magic the Gathering, and hopefully create a bunch of new ones too.
One of the things I was really curious about, because what you'd set up there during the panel, I should probably say we're during the panel at RTX, was how the main thing you look for is to find a new fan.
Yeah.
Which is very different whenever how I've heard like other people talk. Oh, we just need an audience. We need to find a base. And when you talked, you were very passionate about finding another fan.
Yeah.
So to kind of just like conceptualize that, like, is community a big thing for Octopie and works?
Yeah. It absolutely is. I mean, that's the metric that matters the most. There's all these different ways you can try to measure fandom, subscribers, followers, likes, dislikes, all the ratios, the views from all the different platforms. But for us, we don't really care where you find us. But as long as you do, and that when you find it, it's something that really resonates with you. And the way we're experimenting with creating our original IP is all built off this idea that communities are being grown every day, and they're being grown around people that are telling stories that resonate with them. And we want to try to create as many opportunities as possible for people to tell those stories, to potentially reach fans and to resonate with them. And then once you get a fan, you can grow that. You know, you can grow it with more content. You can grow that with different types of content. For us, we want our IP to transcend just animation. We want it to grow into books, games, feature film, live action. It's a springboard for basically creating something something new that people can really like. And animation is really good at that, in my opinion.
So I have to know, how did you become a fan of animation? Like, what got you into this world? Yeah.
So I think, yeah, animation, like being a child of the 80s and 90s, it was just all around. You know, when I was a little kid, maybe 5 or 6 or something like that, my eldest brother, who was, 7 years older than me, would literally wake me up at like 6 o'clock in the morning. And before he had to go to school, I wasn't even going to school yet or whatever the time it was. It might have been like even earlier than that, 4 or 5 years old. And take me downstairs so we could watch G.I. Joe. And it was just the most amazing thing ever. It was still dark outside. We were doing something that kind of felt really kind of special. And that was kind of my earliest memory of animation. But there's just a whole lifetime of animation for me. There was like the first time I discovered anime, you know, which is like just like flipping through the channels when I was like 10 and coming across Toonami or actually that was like the first time I saw like anime, but then like adult anime was like Sci-Fi Channel. I think there was like a showing of Ghost in the Shell.
Yeah.
And I was just like, oh my God, this is the coolest thing ever. The art was so powerful. Like it was unlike anything I'd ever seen before. And it literally my entire life had been understanding animation and being a fan of animation. It literally provoked me into studying animation in school. Like I went to the University of Michigan and I studied, I had like 2 different focuses. One focus was like making things with my hands. Another focus was working on computers doing digital animation, 3D modeling. I worked in After Effects with puppetry animation. And eventually, a senior year in college, I went to Seoul, Korea, South Korea, to be a part of an animation program that I taught animation to college students.
Oh, wow.
So animation was just, it's a really powerful, cool art form that I've always been passionate about.
That's amazing. You've kind of seen it from every single angle, too. So one of the other things, or one of the things that kind of leads into is during the Octopie panel, like one of the things you talked about the panel talked about was kind of as an individual creator, like getting into animation and like kind of keeping with it. From your perspective, what are some like tips you would give to like a younger animator now that maybe just starting out or doesn't know if they should go into animation? Because hearing y'all talk about like the way things have changed is really interesting, because like everybody can get stuff on platforms, but now it's harder to get people to see the stuff. And then I know that like some people may be a little defeated before they start. Like how what would you say to help them out?
Yeah, it's the thing that I've noticed over the last 10 years, maybe even the last 5 years, that it's become even more difficult to survive off of the ad-based revenue off of YouTube, which is still like the primary place to share videos. So I would just suggest keeping that passion alive, you know, like do your day job, make enough money so that you can support yourself. But at night, instead of sitting around watching like, 10 episodes of Stranger Things, binge watching it. No offense, Netflix, I'm sorry. But meaning like, take a break from the watching and create something and do it small. It's okay to do it small. Do it for yourself. Tell your own story. Tell something that gets you out of bed in the morning early before you have to go to work to work on it because you're excited for it. And don't be nitpicky about how it looks, because that's not really the most important thing with animation. It's the story you're telling. If you can be really true to yourself and practice the storytelling aspect of that first, the skill sets and everything else will come later. And it's more rare and the more valuable thing that we look for in Octopie is a good storyteller. And anybody can do that.
That's amazing. Like, kind of hearing you, because like I'm trying to like, as you're talking, I'm going through all the animation that I watch a lot of animation in my head. And I would say like sometimes I may be like, oh, I'm not really a big fan of this animation style, but I'll play it. Like BoJack Horseman is a good example.
Sure.
I was like, that looks weird. I don't know if I want to watch it. But then I just fell in love with the characters and just buried myself in it.
Absolutely. I mean, that's what it takes. It's not like you might get your attention for a second, like, oh, that looks cool. And then you might watch and be like, that's not cool. Like, and there could be so much money and so much effort and like hundreds, if not thousands of people's like top of their skill sets being utilized to create that piece of animation. But if it's not a story worth telling, then nobody cares.
So like kind of like bringing that into like magic and stuff, like mm-hmm. this is a world that has been around for so long and is so vast, so expansive. What is the, I mean, I know you can't share any story details, but what is the process of kind of like distilling so much information down into one narrative, and in a narrative that like ultimately, like you said, can bring in new fans, but also pays attention to people who have kind of like devoted their lives to the game?
Oh, absolutely. It's tough. And I think one thing we can look at is that it's both a good and a bad, is that there's no right way to tell this story. It's a massive world. And for us, we're just looking to take what we think is going to be an interesting path through it with just a handful of characters and allow you to really live in these characters, to make the world real, and for you to start caring about the characters and the story and the journey that they're on. And we're looking for a really grounded story, something that can allow people to still relate to these people, even though that they're, you know, very, very magical and from a completely different plane or existence. And it's, I mean, the idea of planes themselves is like a humongous idea. We don't want our story to revolve around the fact that the people go from plane to plane. For us, it's really about telling a good story first and then a magic story second. And the fact that this is the first time that people have ever seen this incredibly loved IP timed story, video format, whatever you want to call it. It also means that we have a lot to like establish. We could easily be like exhausted and scared of trying to tell all that story at once. And instead of taking that route, we're looking at like, let's just tell a really concise human character driven story. And from there, we'll build on it, and episode after episode, and hopefully season after season, we'll continue to live in different parts of the magic world, and it will ultimately paint a really massive picture of this incredible universe that's been developed by Wizards of the Coast.
I know you mentioned in the panel about like you wanted this, like it was going to be scary, and I guess like mm-hmm. adult themes. Can you kind of like elaborate on that?
Sure. it was really important for us to differentiate ourselves from kids animation, and because we wanted a sophisticated story that is for adults. So because of wanting to like really concrete that, when we were looking at our characters and deciding which characters we wanted to use, we decided to go with some pretty scary ones. And because magic is like, there is everything in this IP, from the deepest, darkest underworlds of zombies and flesh-eating to monsters and demons, to fairies and beautiful cathedrals floating in the sky, you know, like a humongous world. We figured by getting really gritty and dark and scary, we could tell a unique story for animation, and also give us one pull to start at that we'll eventually go to another pull. So we will it was kind of a passion thing. Like it was very easy for us all to get passionate about like horror and like it might be not just my personalities, but Joe and Anthony's, but we had a lot of big ideas about what we wanted to do with the series. And it wasn't until we started distilling them that the things that we kind of were continuing to hit on over and over again was this idea that that horror can be a really powerful storytelling device to develop character, and it's not utilized enough.
That makes my heart sing, because I'm a giant horror fan, like a big horror fan, and that kind of like brings up my next question. A lot of the best, like a lot of really good horror animation comes from Japan, and it starts in like horror manga and stuff like that. Like, are you taking, when it comes to like bringing a lot of like, I don't want to say tropes, but like horror storytelling methods, like what are some things that you may be utilizing, or like and because I don't want to ask too much, but like just kind of like
I know. You can ask all you want.
I'm trying to craft it. Yeah, that may not be a good question. I'm just thinking, like, there are so many ways to use horror to tell a story, mm-hmm. right? Body horror tells a specific type of story. Yeah. Like, possession tells another type of story. Like, what elements of horror, and do you see mesh really well with fantasy in both in storytelling mediums? Because they both have similar but mm-hmm. very different takes on storytelling.
Totally.
And when I think a lot of people think of magic, they think totally of fantasy, mm-hmm. and they don't know how to bridge that. Like, how do you bridge between fantasy and horror?
Yeah, well...
Or is it going to be a bridge or lean more one way?
Like, you know, again, like, our characters and our stories are going to feel really real, and they're going to be really lived in, and our characters are going to be relatable. So the fantasy elements of it come from our setting, and not from necessarily just our characters. It comes from, you know, the power that a lot of these characters have, but we didn't want to tell like a fantasy story. We definitely have some things that we looked at from Japanese horror that were inspirational to us. Like Vampire Hunter D was like one that was like, yeah, if we do like half of that right, we're going to be in a good place. But we also wanted to make sure that our animation style was not going to be recognizable as Japanese. We're not trying to create like an American anime. You know, we're doing something in look and feel that I think is going to be really original. And that was really important to us. And as we utilize that look and feel and how we utilize that with horror, it's more about loss in our characters, you know, stakes, things that are painful and are recognizable at being such, and the absence of things more than the addition of things. Our dark space in our show is what's going to, I think, give it a really cool, scary personality.
I'm just like super excited. Like, I was excited when I came into this, and then hearing you talk, I'm like even more excited.
I wish I could show some.
I mean, I guess that's really all I have. I guess one of the things that I am interested to know is, I know in the RTX panel, there was a lot of talk of the current state of animation kind of facilitating this more adult content, more adult driven. But also one of the things that I'm thinking of, Netflix as a platform is now bringing in something that is seen traditionally as more niche in magic and making it essentially mainstream by putting it on its platform. Mm-hmm. Do you feel some of that pressure of kind of having it in your hands and bringing it to a mainstream audience?
Yeah, for sure. I mean, it's really important for us that we give fans of magic something that they're going to really, really, really like and enjoy, and it fits within their imaginations of what the lore means for a story to be told with magic. But at the same time, you know, we have a real need to service the IP in making it bigger and helping it grow and helping people find it. Because the card game is really intimidating for people. It's a very intense strategy game. And it's not just to get into that. If you're not, you know, from friends or family or whatever your path in life was that didn't bring you into a hobby shop and like allowed you to like dork out in those types of scenarios, a lot of people didn't have that. So that the magic is just one of those things that they may have heard of, may have seen before, and never knew really what it was about. But this is an opportunity with a platform like Netflix, a little bit of the challenge of animation is that it's not like not as mainstream as live action would be, but we think that we're not going to let that hold us back. But our main goal with utilizing a platform like Netflix is to open it up, to allow it for anybody that comes and watches our show is going to get something that that has gravity, something that's going to get them into magic, make them new fans of magic, and fans of our series and fans of our characters, and want to be on board for not just the series that we're producing for Netflix, but the next series that comes after that, and potentially the sky's the limit if it's going to be feature films or other big things that can be grown out of this. It will hopefully bring a lot of people to the table that are not necessarily players of magic. It's similar to the people that never read a comic book but are huge fans of Marvel because of the movies and all the different ways that they can experience and enjoy the IP.
I want to ask you, is there any IP out there that you personally as a passion project would like to bring to animation?
So I in fact I'm not going to say any of them because too many of them are are close, like within reach. I'll just kind of say it in the most general terms. I'm a big video game fan. Like I grew up playing video games. Some of the best stories and story experiences I've ever had have come from video games. And too many of those stories, I feel like, have not been told right with other mediums like animation. And it would be a dream come true to work with some of those IPs in an animated storytelling way to expand upon them. Like what frustrates me often is that this idea that you have to tell the same story over again, but just in a different medium. For me, I want to reinforce the story that everybody loves in a new way, in a new story, to expand the universe and to show different sides of characters that might have not been so important to the stories that made a particular IP famous. So ancillary supporting content. I think of the Matrix anime series as the Animatrix as a really powerful group of content that showed all the different ways that that people were experiencing the Matrix and breaking out of it, or what was happening behind the scenes and outside of just the movies. And that type of expansion to the IP, I thought, was just incredible. And I would like to see more stuff like that.
Awesome. And this is our last question. So our podcast, our website initially started as our podcast, and our podcast's main focus is looking at why pop culture matters. Mm-hmm. So we want to know what piece of pop culture matters the most to you and why.
Oh man.
I know it's a big question. It's hard for me to answer myself a lot of the time.
Pop culture matters the most to me and why. Well, my life is going to be highly focused on Magic the Gathering. So that is definitely a huge piece that matters a lot to me. And it's hard to pick a specific IP for this, but I don't know if I can really go wrong with saying Magic right now. I think Magic would be that. It's because of... I can't. It's because Magic shows something really unique that's happening. There is a chance for a subculture. When I say sub, I mean smaller culture of people that are huge fans of something that over 25 years have grown that fandom, and that fandom's gotten to the point that now it's like breaking free and breaking to the surface. Versus things like Star Wars or whatnot that started there in the light and continues to be in the light and has been for decades. This is something that grew underneath, and it's become so massive that it can no longer be ignored. And I think that's what's really, really powerful about fandoms, that it can be really niche, and it can be something that builds community and friendships and be really big in your life. And there's no telling where it's going to end up and going, end up as it grows.
Awesome. Well, thank you so much for talking with us. This is amazing.
Thank you both. Yeah. Fun conversation. Thanks for having me.